Hello there, Goobers. Welcome back to our dialogue system tutorial. I'm here to ask you a very important question. What do you want for breakfast? Yes, today we'll be adding in branching dialogue. We'll create choices that the player can select that will change the course of the conversation. We'll also add a go-to command that automatically changes the conversation so that two branches can merge back together. Let's start by taking a look at our asset tree. We have mostly the same assets from the previous videos, but we've also added in a sprite options and a sprite option arrow. So sprite options is going to be the box that our choices are surrounded by, and sprite option arrow is going to be the indicator for which one you're currently selecting. Like the previous features that we've added, we're going to need to create some new variables. So let's head to the create event of our text box object, and we'll add in some new customizable properties concerning options. First, like most of the stuff we've done so far, we need to define where our options are going to be placed. So let's add an X and a Y variable to position our options. You can see the Y position of my options is set to padding times -6, so it's going to be raised up quite a bit, such that it's above the text box. Some more positioning properties we need are how far apart our options are, and also how far inward the currently selected option is going to be indented. So the option that we're currently selecting is going to be pushed a little bit to the right, to make it more visually clear that it's the currently selected one. We also need to define how wide and how tall each option is. The option sprite that we're using is a 9-slice, so this can stretch depending on what size we tell it to be, and it won't deform at the edges at all. And we're also going to need to specify where our text is positioned. So text X will define where inside the option the text is placed. And text color is going to be the color of the text inside the option. Now we only need three more variables, and these are going to be some private variables. So we're going to add in an options array, which will contain all of the current options you can pick from, the current option that you're selecting, and how many options there are in total. And those are all of our option variables. We're also going to want to add some more input variables because we need to be able to check for the up and down arrow key being pressed. So let's add an up key and a down key variable. And those are all of the variables that we need to create. So now we can move on to our other events. We will need to write step event code because the player is going to need to be able to give input and select options. Options are only going to be presented when we're done typing, so we're going to put all of our option code inside the if statement that checks if we're finished or not. And when options are available, it changes the way that normally pressing the confirm key works. So we won't just go to the next page, we need to run our option code. So depending on if there are options or not, we'll run either our option code or we'll run the regular advance to the next page code. When we have options, we need to check if we're pressing the up or down key, so we'll set some new local variables like we do with the confirm key, and then we'll check how much we're changing. So we can either be changing by nothing if we're not pressing up or down, or we can be changing by 1 if we're pressing down and not up, or we can be changing by -1 if we're pressing up and not down. If we are moving, then we're going to change our current selection. And we're also going to make sure that we wrap around if we try going past the last or the first option. Then, if the player presses the confirm key, we'll grab whichever option we're currently selecting. We'll reset our options array so that it's no longer full of options, so that we don't get presented with the same options on the next page. And then we're going to do whatever that option tells us to do. So you can see we're calling an act method in our option. And that means that our options are going to be a dialogue action, like the other ones we've made before that all had act methods. But before we create that action, we're going to first add in the visuals and go to our Draw GUI event. And we're going to go all the way to the bottom, past everything else we've written so far. And if we have finished typing our text and there are options, then we're going to draw those options right here. To start off, we'll just get some drawing properties out of the way, make sure that our text is middle aligned, and we'll also make the text the right color. Then we're going to loop through all of our options, starting at 0, going to option count. Then we'll figure out where the current option is supposed to be placed. You can see the Y position gets subtracted by quite a lot, so it gets moved up for each option. But as I goes up, this becomes a smaller and smaller number. The reason why we do it like this is because we want the first option to be the topmost one, but we also want it to go higher and higher as more options are added in. So if there were two options, the topmost one would be lower than if there were three options, because you'd be stacking more one on top of another. If the current option is the same as the selected option that we have, then we're going to bump it over to the right a little bit, and we're also going to draw our arrow next to it. And then whether or not this is the selected one, we still need to draw the options, so we'll draw the option sprite using the stretched function again, because it's a 9-slice, and we'll also draw our text inside it. And that takes care of the visual part, so now let's go to our dialogue actions and add in some choice actions. This time we're going to need to add 3 new dialogue actions. The first one we're going to add is a choice action. So you can see it accepts a text argument, and this is just like the question that you're currently asking that the player will select choices about. But it also takes in extra arguments. So we're using the argument array, and every argument after the first one is going to get put inside an options array. So you'll specify what the question is, and then also what all the possible answers are. When the choice actions act method is called, it's going to set the text box's text. It's also going to give it all of its options. It'll set how many options there are, and it'll also reset the selected option to the first one. Now, the question on your mind right now is probably, what kind of arguments do we pass in after the text argument? So we're going to be passing in option actions, which are the next action that we're going to be creating. And option actions store the possible answers that you can give to any given choice. They take text, what the actual option text says, and they also take a topic, which is going to be where the dialogue is going to go when you select this option. So the way an option works is when you select it, it changes the topic of conversation to whatever the option action points to. So if I have an option that points to topic 1 and an option that points to topic 2, and I select the first option, then the dialogue is going to run all of the text inside topic 1. But if I select the second option, then the text box is going to run all of the dialogue in topic 2. And the last action that we need isn't really related to choices, but it is related to moving around to different topics. We're going to add the go-to action. And the go-to action is kind of like an automatic change in topic. The reason why this is going to be useful is because if you have branching dialogue where you want those two branches to merge back together at some point, then they're going to need to both go to the same topic at some point without any input from the player. So this is an automatic change that doesn't prompt you with a choice. And once again, like our other actions, we made macros for text and speaker. I'm going to again add macros for each of our new actions just to make writing the dialogue a little easier. So let's see this in action. Let's see how it looks if we write some actual dialogue that takes advantage of choices. I'm going to write some simple dialogue that just asks what you want for breakfast, and the player can choose either eggs or pancakes. You can see that my choice action is enclosing these two option actions because we're passing these options as arguments to the choice command. If the player chooses eggs, then we're going to go to a new topic called choose eggs, or chose eggs, I guess. And if we choose the pancakes option, then we're going to go to a new topic called chose pancakes. So let's write the chose eggs topic now. And I'm just going to comment on how that's a good, healthy option for breakfast. And if you choose pancakes, I mean, it's not as healthy, but it's yummy. So let's just comment on that as well. And let's say that regardless of which option you pick, we want to tell the player goodbye now at the end of the breakfast conversation. Well, to do that, we just need to add in a go-to command to each of these branches that points to the end of breakfast topic. So as the conversation starts, you get asked, what do you want for breakfast? If you choose eggs, you go to the chose eggs topic, which then in turn goes to the end of breakfast topic, which tells you goodbye now. Let's try this out. We'll edit our demo object so that it talks about the breakfast dialogue, and we'll try running the game. So now we get asked, what do you want for breakfast? And you can see I have two options to pick from. If I choose eggs, then I get told that's a healthy way to start the day. And afterwards, it went to the end of breakfast conversation as well. If I try again, and I select the pancakes option, then they tell me how yummy that is. And once again, regardless of which option I picked, it went to the end of breakfast conversation at the end. And that takes care of branching dialogue and adding some interactivity to your dialogue system. With that, we've covered what I believe is the fundamental aspects of dialogue systems, so you should have a pretty complete system at this point. There are other things that you can add on top, for example, text effects or custom actions like adding items to a player's inventory depending on the option they pick or setting a quest flag. And adding all of those things into this system is pretty straightforward, which we might cover in a future video. But for now, so long, goobers.